Let's say hello to Georg on stage. So Georg is presenting his talk on Sling Felix Health Checks. So welcome, Georg.
Hi, everyone. Yeah, thanks. So it's late in the afternoon, but I try to present it in a nice way so no one falls asleep. My name is Georg Hensler. I work for Netcentric. Netcentric, some people of you might know because of the AEC tool. I also have contributed there. But I'm also a committed and PMC member at Sling and now also at Felix because like one of the modules that I did a lot of work on have moved, and that's what it's all about today, the move. But what is it all about? Like I'll try to keep this short because hopefully you already know this. But there is a bit of a history lesson. So Bertrand initially created this slides from Bertrand 2013, also from here adapt to just a basic interface to, and it's all about like being able to tell if an instance is good or not. And a year later, I made some improvements. It was about like how you collaborate, how you are better to extend it, how like in the DevOps sense. How you do it, and especially back then, it was already really clear that external systems are important. So it's not only users manually looking at results. Back then, it was already clear that we will have external systems that automatically react on these results. And like this year, it was all about Kubernetes. But yeah, so we'll look into that a little bit, and then like the thing that came in was like an executor, which is basically a container. Yeah, a container, Docker is also a container, but like, you know, like a frame around like executing the checks that did it in a healthy way and especially in parallel, because if you're able to contribute to an instance lots of checks, you really have to make sure that you do it as efficiently as possible. And I absolutely share the passion for performance that Ruben showed in the front end. Also like in backend services infrastructure, it's really important to have things performant. And yeah, basically, I just checked a little bit. Basically, you can health checks or the things are sometimes called different, but like pretty much any tool you find out there, you can configure them somehow, even in the very experienced manager dispatcher itself, which is rarely used because you usually don't use it for load balancing. I checked if you can use it in SharePoint, and I didn't find anything. So if someone give me a pointer, I'd love to actually configure it in SharePoint one day. And obviously like Docker Kubernetes, also Docker itself has the concept, and yeah, Kubernetes, we've seen it lots already. But whenever you move, why would you move? Because it's heavy lifting, there's lots of stuff you have to move, there's always something that breaks, and often when you move, years later, there's still all the unpacked boxes, and yeah, so it is work. So why did we move? We moved anyway, and for those reasons. We had, like, basically, it's a low-level thing, it's clear. Like, if the instance is there or not, it is very low-level. The most low-level framework we have today in AEM or in the Sling stack is Felix. That's the basis of everything. That's what starts first. Yes, Carl agrees. And, like, we had some dependencies just because it was possible at the time it was implemented, so we removed it. Also, in a way, it's good to have them in Felix because it makes it available to a broader audience. And if it's a great tool, why not make it available for a broader audience? Then there was the system ready that was created because it was really needed in Felix at the very foundation. And like it did some things, and obviously there was some good ideas, and there was some things that weren't as advanced yet as health checks already were. And so it was the idea, okay, let's merge it, and like one big reason to have system ready at the time was to improve the startup shutdown behavior, and I'll show later how we achieved that in this combined version. So I said like moving is always work, and like whoever has moved or checked under the couch, like usually if you find dust, you find maybe old keys or toys and like whatever, like I think everyone has found something funny under a couch when you actually move. So it's also an opportunity for cleanup. So that's what we did. So one thing is status values. So health checks, traditionally, it was always like it was okay, or it could be worn, or it could be critical. In a way, it's self-explanatory what it means. There's also the health check error, which basically means like you can only treat it as critical, but you indicate you don't even know, like while checking, you couldn't find a proper result, and you don't know what it is. So maybe it's even okay, but you can't really make it okay. But there's a new one now, and in the discussion about how we could merge like system ready and health checks, it became clear that it's actually a difference between, like, if you talk about traffic lights, you have amber. And in some countries, there's amber black, amber red and just amber, which indicates the difference between if you're going towards green or if you're going towards red. So this is really important. So you have an additional status now. You can temporary unavailable means that you you can't use the system, but it's a tendency to, okay, so just wait, it'll be all good for optimistic people. And actually the framework, the executor, after a configurable amount of time, will automatically turn to critical, because if you tell a client that it's probably going to be all right soon, and it never becomes all right, then at some point it becomes critical automatically without you adding any code. In other cleanups, so there was a bit like, there was an info and OK status, which sort of was a bit of a mix of logging and a status. So this is now just a status, and like you can still use the formatting result log. It's just done, implemented a bit differently. Obviously, annotations change, like we have with OSGIR 7, we have like component property types. And so I show this in a bit, how this looks like. One interesting one is actually the default tag. So now talking about AEM, AEM has used this extensively. You have lots and lots of tags. And actually, if you run it on a clean instance, no matter if you use like production mode or not, then they'll never be okay out of the box, because basically there's tags for pre-upgrade, and they'll never be green, because you have to do certain things which take down the system before you start the upgrade. So in a sense, it never makes sense to run all checks for all tags today, for an AEM instance at least. And to cater for that, that was introduced. So if you don't give a tag, the default will be default, so a tag with the name default. You still can run all tags if you absolutely need to. You can just use an asterisk. So this is just a detail, but it was just like it was called for testing, like the suggestible status check. I show this later for like deployment sequences. You can actually use it for production deployments, and then it's really stupid if it's called for testing, because really you can use it for production. And the system ready checks, they were really good, and they basically just use a different SPA interface now. Once you start touching something, then it's a good time to actually add a few new things. So there are a couple of checks that you can just use out of the box. So I think I saw something in the Shine Solutions code that also have like just for bundle starters and stuff like that. So it's not a lot of code, but today you can just use a configuration, which is always better than even like those 20 lines of code. Disk-based memory, like a couple of things. Often you wouldn't necessarily have this as a master in the health check, but in other monitoring, but it's really useful and helpful to have this for minimal setups. Also, JMX attributes, HTTP requests, you can have a scripted checks. I show all of that in a little bit. Another interesting aspect is the logging. So how the result is constructed, usually you have this formatting result log, and you do something like log info and you say something. And then in theory, depending on what you're actually checking, you might also want to have the same message in the log file. So doing this is obviously, you can easily do it two messages one after another, but it's duplication, it's not that nice. So if you have a means now to lock to a special category, so you're only in your implementation, you only have one line, and then you can, like, all your locking setup can be set up in a way that it uses it automatically correctly, and you have auto-derived categories. And filters, so yeah, this is part of, like, the startup shutdown sequences that I'll show in a bit, but also so you need it for that, and there's also for the deployment, there's another filter. So this didn't exist before, so I show this. To say it more properly, so basically there was a filter in AEM or in Sling that was used. There was actually a couple, but we'll see that in a bit. But first, let's talk about how to migrate. So maybe you have used health checks just out of the box once, and you've never actually implemented one with an SPA interface. So then you basically only migrate the runtime, and then you're done, because you don't have any code that relies on a dependency. So if you use the Sling starter, this is all done. You just use the latest one. It's not released yet because Sling 11 didn't have it yet. Then it's easy. But in general, what needs to be done, so you have like a couple of health check bundles, and for obviously you might want to deploy code that has a dependency to the old health check API from Sling, which is very similar but not exactly the same. So you just use the same API, so you have two API bundles, and the core from Felix will be able to handle both. And then obviously lots of you use AEM, and for 6.4, 6.5, there's a migration kit that I released also today, and the code is on GitHub, so all the links are on the references. So there is some code that makes it, it's basically pretty much configurations and a package that upgrades your instance. And any future versions of AEM, like soon, that will be migrated on AEM side as well. And a little thing that has changed is also that the JMX paths have changed. So if you're doing monitoring directly on a JMX path, or you use like JMX endpoints, so this might have changed. Like very little, you just replace Sling by Felix, but you have to do that. So question to everyone before someone falls asleep. Like, who is using health checks? OK, quite a few. Who is actually using those JMX endpoints in Jenkins monitoring or any third-party tooling? OK, so it's not that many. So this is a message to Christian, because we had a discussion about it, how problematic this change is and how much it will break out there. So it's not going to be that much. I think I saw three hands. Yeah, here Christian is, like, he's happy. That's good. So runtimes, but also you might have code, you might have your custom health checks. So what do? You adjust the Maven dependencies, you best case you just organize your imports because the class names are pretty much the same, and you have to change the annotation, which is fairly similar but just a little bit different. And then you have like it used to be just one annotation, now we have like a couple more, and if you use async health checks or stickiness or you really use this debug, then you might have to do a bit more. But the message is, like, the gray stuff, usually most of the time you won't have to do it. And then it's all fine. So how does it look like? So yeah, dependency change, easy. So just as an example, that's how an old one looks like. This is a new one. So, and if you look at it, this looks almost worse than CDI annotations. So the point here is actually, so this is just like the full Monty of what you potentially can use. So it gets a lot easier if you just use the minimal set. So here you're missing the meta type annotation, so you can't configure it, but maybe you don't, or you cannot configure it in UI, but maybe you don't need that. So it can be as easy as that. I really wanted to make sure that you know that it's easy enough. As I said, so new feature, there are some configurable checks. So yeah, I think I listed them in a previous slide already. There's a scripted check, so the one that we had in Sling, it was a bit tricky, and like you quickly needed to write some Java code to have some extra bindings, and now it's a bit easier. You can, like, you just have a session and you can do things. I'll show in a bit. Bertrand wrote initially that simple constraint checker that can do even a lot more now than it used to be able to do. And the good thing is, all of this, like writing code, usually you have to do a release, and if you're in a reasonable good DevOps setup, that it's maybe not all that complicated. But like if Saturday night you have a problem, and on Sunday morning, and you're worried, and you wanna really monitor something over the Sunday, best case, you never have to do that because you don't have issues, have you? But if you have, maybe that's reasonable. So this is configuration only. This can be scripted. This can be like an like one person operations team. And have the full flexibility. So this is just an example of how this looks like. So you just create a configuration. It's a configuration factory, and you give the typical names. Most of you have used it. So now also you, like sometimes you can, depending on the checks, you can influence what this actually would mean then. So in this case, we want to say it's temporary unavailable for the case that the installer has a suspended since which is older than 2 seconds. So basically, if there's a recent installation action that was taking place, this thing will return temporarily unavailable, which is useful for something I show later. Another one is the scripted one. Like everyone knows the pause installation, or best case, not everyone, because you shouldn't have to know, but I guess enough people got in touch with it. Anyway, so this checks will just tell you if there is a pause installation node, and also that is not a bad thing, as long as it goes away after some point again. So this checks will exactly do that. And maybe just a note. So this is like the scripted check where you can, in this case, write JavaScript, because I noted it here. You can install just like it's using the script engines. You can just install the Groovy bundle, which is not out of the box, but if you have it, then you can use here Groovy, and then you just write Groovy. In the end, you don't want to write a lot of code. Usually it's in the magnitude of this, and then it doesn't really matter if it's JavaScript, Groovy, or anything else. And you can reference the script. So you could also write it directly in this one line, or use escaping for new lines, or you know, all these things, but it's nicer to have it in a separate file. Oh yeah, a bit of demo. So this, okay, let's see. So I just want to show, so we're at Adapt2, right? And it turns out that Adapt2.org is in Berlin. So this is just like a simple check, an external, I want to show the request check. So this is just on the command line. And you can also configure this as a check. So sometimes you would use local, or you would check against localhost. If you just use slash, it automatically derives the port. But you can also, yeah, you can check REST services, you know, like all these things that potentially are down, and you want to quickly see the status. And you have here like a request spec, and it basically just says like, I really want to have a 200, and I want to make sure that the city is in Berlin. So I want to make sure that Adapt2 is in Berlin. And yeah, I can go, so it's as easy as that. I can go save. And okay, I had this before, I have to admit. And it's telling me exactly that. So yeah, so should be Berlin, it is Berlin. I can also just say, like if I have a different opinion, I think it should be in Potsdam. So I'm neutral to this discussion, but. So let's say, okay, to not have a bug, let's do it twice. And yeah, I just save it like that. And then I reload it, and it fails. So yeah, you get the idea. And the important bit is you can have many of those, and you can run them in parallel. So, I mean, it's a bit stupid to do it like that, but the quickest way is just to have a few of them. So I could do this. It's not very reasonable, but if I then, so I just see I have it three times. So that's easy enough, and also performance optimized. So it runs them also in parallel within this one check. So that's what it looks like. But now to startup shutdown. So what did we have? So last year, we had 503 on startup. Most of the time, like when you really monitored it, you saw that there was usually some 404 in between until you got to the 503. And on shutdown, it was just like nothing. So at some point, you could have an error. Like it was undefined. For AEM, like that was Sling. And for AEM, we had a slightly different mechanism, also like all relying on filters. And it was, it worked, but it was not reliable in the sense that the first response you would get would actually be a nice 503. And because of the dependencies, that was not possible with the health checks, with system ready, that was possible, but for the reasons explained, so we merged it all together, and now we have health checks in Felix, and we can do exactly that really nicely. And Robert also mentioned it briefly, it's already working in the Sling starter. And today, so basically, we can have via this system unavailable filter, we can have 503 really for startup and shutdown. So it might not matter that much for shutdown, but really it's nice to just have the proper result. Like if it's shutting down, it's unavailable, and at some point it's completely gone. And the whole thing is basically just a configuration that checks certain health checks. And now it's consistent, and also like extensible is maybe the coolest about this feature. So if you really have something that you rely on top of the regular AEM or Sling or whatever you have, you just give it, you write a health check, you give it the right tag, and this will also do the same thing. I'll do the demo together. So now we have the service unavailable filter does exactly that. Explained that already, but there's also another filter which dynamically adds a health check result for configured requests. So you could do it for Felix System Console if you upload a bundle, but this is usually quick. But like the typical use case, like deployments in AEM, they take a bit, and the request comes back, but not everything is processed. All these things, and like the feature model and all this stuff will also solve it, but a lot of people are still using what we have today, so we have a solution for that. No, I'm not done, because this was actually the point where I wanted to show some things. I just have a basic HA proxy configuration that uses... I have a HA proxy and two publishers. I don't have dispatches running, just for simplicity. And as with any load balancer, you can configure URLs to check, and you say how often they can fail on the way to healthy and on the way back. It uses sticky sessions for this setup, as we heard, this is a good practice at the moment anyway. It's a Docker container also in the Sling, in this repo I linked. You can also just run this. It's a really easy setup. But what does this look like? So let's start with one thing first. So I'm watching the response to the first publisher that I have, and maybe, so this is just our website and locally. And so this is the first publisher that I have, and I just run this, and it's just like a fairly simple page. 300 milliseconds, not too bad. And I'm just going to monitor that. I have a little script, which is also in this Git repo, and you just see, it's actually doing a lot more requests. It's only outputting, I think, every 10th request. So it's really, it's not multi-threading, but it's doing lots and lots of requests in sequence, and once the response code changes, it quickly shows it here. So what can I do? I can restart, publish one, and I have some automation here to actually do that, but Maven-based, this doesn't really matter, but I already see, here this goes to 503 error. I can also reload here, and I see what I actually get. I also get that this is 2 milliseconds. So the stuff is really, I have a passion for performance, 2 milliseconds for this 503 request. Like, it's not really doing anything. Like, at the very outer shell of this instance, it's just saying no and go, which is good. So, So now it's already starting up again, which, yeah. So I missed the point. There was a small point where the instance didn't answer at all. So I missed that while talking. And yeah, obviously I can go a bit reload. And I'll see that this is, yeah, well, and this is like startup times will improve, right? We've heard that. it's not that bad. It'll be just a bit. Okay, it's back. Great. And you see here, so it changed back. So you see this. But that was only one instance. And also, so now I didn't look at this. And I didn't look at this and this. So this is just so this is the plain health check result of publish two, one and two. This is the publisher one and two, so 5103 and four. I have the statistic from HA proxy, just like a management console, and I have like on port 8000, I happen to have like this load balanced site, which also works at the moment. So now to make it more interesting, so I watch this load balancer is up here. So I have nicely 200 coming. Oh no, that was the wrong one. Come. So this is the second publisher. Yeah, and now you can watch a lot of stuff, so you should all keep an eye on the on that left-hand side. So can you see it? Is it, or maybe I can probably make it a bit bigger. Messes other stuff up. Right, and then I can do a I publish one and two. So now what I do now, I do in a sequence, like I don't do any other orchestration, so that's the part of the point here. I don't do any orchestration. I just deploy those packages in a sequence with like a reasonably clever load balancer configuration. I just run this and yeah, you have to watch the response code on the left. Let's go down here a bit. Here we go. So the first one, and I can check here. So the first one went red, and I can check here, and yes, temporarily unavailable. And I can check here, and I see the second one is still there. The first one is gone with ongoing deployment, and here the load balancer shows like nicely the same as this console window. But now I see it's actually, now it's back. So if I go here, it already started with the second one. And I see the errors here. And now this is back to normal. I can check here, back to normal. And yeah. So, and yeah, I mean, it's all a few response codes. And what is it? What's really the cool thing about it? The really cool thing about it is that we reliably didn't have anything strange here. So those 200 requests, they are reliably always there. And they reliably always had a correct rendering. Because the problem is if you don't do like an orchestrated deployment, like best case, like while you're deploying, you get like an error message, and then it's okay because no one's going to cache it and all load balancers are going to throw the stuff away. But what can happen is that just a piece of your HTML rendering is missing and you get the 200, and then it gets through the whole chain, worst case, all the way out to Akamai, and then like 2 days later, people are investigating how this piece of HTML got all the way out to the edge. So, yeah, this is a way to avoid all this. So, I think I'm actually, I was worried I would take way too long. It's okay. So, we have references. So, there is the Felix health check documentation, which is, yeah, here in Git or like, yeah, there's the README. Most of the documentation is there. Obviously, to migrate it, there's also on Sling side, there's a couple of documentation pages. Also, some things remain in Sling because they make sense in Sling, like some like the scripted check that provides the session binding, because Felix wouldn't know about that. So this is all documented. And like for the people that today are on AEM 6.4 or 6.5, This is just a module. This is just packages of configuration. I'll actually just show you to make clear what it is. So this is just a few packages that you can install, and they contain only configurations and references to the bundle that have been released in Sling. So there's no Java code. It's all just, actually, you can, GitHub is cool. So it's a bit of shell script, JavaScript, and Dockerfile. Ah, there's a Dockerfile. So what is that? That is actually just this HA proxy, and you can look at this. I mean, yeah. Anyway, nothing too fancy. Today, we all know how this works. I don't need to show it. And that is it. 3 minutes over. Not sure. Have we time? Like, for one or two questions, if they're there?
Right. Okay, it looks like there are no questions, so thank you for being on stage. Mm-hmm.
Thanks.